you leave so that we can get them cleaned and turned for the next presentation. It's my pleasure to present our next speaker, Jeremy Rasmussen. He's the CTO, CISO of Avocode, a company that provides managed cybersecurity and compliance advisory purposes to business across all industries. He's also an adjunct professor right here at the University of South Florida, where he founded the USF White Hatters Computer Security Club. Since 2000, he's taught courses in cryptography, network security, ethical hacking, digital forensics and investigation, and mobile and wireless security. For 25 years, he's performed R&D of cyber solutions for government and commercial customers. Jeremy has even a lower CISSP number than me, and is a certified ethical hacker. He was named 2017 Tampa Bay Technology Leader of the Year. For his presentation, Post-Quantum Cryptography, please welcome Jeremy Rasmussen.
Thank you, David. Ladies and gentlemen, honored guests, can you hear me okay? Give me a thumbs up in the back. Sweet. All right, so this is entitled Complete Idiot's Guide to Post-Quantum Cryptography. I'm the idiot, not you guys. I really did it for myself. As David mentioned, I've been teaching at USF for about 20 years. Some other shout outs. Avocode Cybersecurity is the company I'm a partner and CTO for. We actually have an office right across there in USF Connect Research Park where we do managed cybersecurity services for companies. As you mentioned, WCSC is the ethical hacking club. We started at USF in 2005. I've already seen a lot of alumni from there today. Great to see everybody. Undercroft is a place we've actually opened a remote office now down in Ybor City. I'm a guild master of the Undercroft. If you're looking for a way to connect into the InfoSec community, you know, through an apprenticeship, journeyman, or guild master, think about doing the Undercroft. You know, if about the cost of a health club membership, you can be connected and get great training all the time and talking to, you know, other InfoSec professionals. And thanks again for BSides for inviting me. Here's the folks that influenced me on this journey. All these folks are doing work in quantum cryptography, quantum computing, or just quantum physics. The journey I took, the one that kind of kept me up at night and gave me interesting dreams over the last few weeks and months, was understanding quantum physics a little bit first, and then getting into quantum computing, and then talking about quantum safe algorithms. So what we're going to talk about is, you know, what is quantum computing? What is quantum safe computing? What are the implications of it? Why do we care about it? Why is it so important that we solve this problem right now today and not sometime in the future? And then what are we actually doing about it in terms of emerging algorithms, and approaches to try to beat quantum computers? So the problem is, and we're going to talk about this in detail, is public key crypto systems are based on trapdoor examples. So, I mean, factoring numbers, discrete logarithm, elliptic curve cryptography. I'm going to go into these a little bit more, but these are easy to compute in one direction, but difficult to reverse in the other direction, right? Unless they're not. The issue is that, you know, these are used for everything on the internet in terms of SSL, TLS, public message, signature, key exchange, encrypting basically all secrets on the internet. Quantum computing poses a threat to that by being able to undo or crack these cipher codes either instantaneously or within a finite amount of time. So now we're putting, you know, nation state secrets at risk, financial transactions, and all privacy. So the question is, how close are we to a new Y2K type issue where we need to come up with a solution right away? Well, let's look at the basics of PK, public key cryptography. Started back in the 70s. NSA might have actually known how to do it before that with Whitfield Diffie, Martin Hellman, who said, let's make some assumptions. Say we have a pair of integer functions, E, a public function, and D, a private function, that are going to operate on messages M. And I wish I had a big whiteboard where I could draw, but I don't. So I'm just going to talk you through this. So we're going to make the following assumptions. If you apply the D function to the E function of the message, you get the plain text message. And if you apply the E function to the D function of the message, you get the message. So it's reversible, right? However, given the E function, which is a public function that you make available to others to send you encrypted messages, you're not able to determine the D. And vice versa, given a D, it's not possible to determine E. And by not possible, what I mean by that is, let's loosen the conditions. I don't think right now we don't have really any completely unbreakable cipher, and we'll talk about that too when we get to quantum cryptography. But if we make it computationally infeasible to do that, then that's just about the same as saying impossible, right? So each person is going to have a pair of functions that they're going to use to satisfy those equations, and they're going to make their E function public, their D function private. Well, that means we can do a lot of cool stuff with that, right? Imagine this. If I want to send you a secret message, you give me your public key. I encrypt the message with your public key and send it to you. Then you use your private key to decrypt it. Only you can decrypt that message because only you have the private key. You'll give to the public key to really whoever you want to send you a trusted secret message. On the flip side of that, if you take a little piece of data and you encrypt it with your private key and then send it out, only the person that has the corresponding public key to your private key, I mean, which is anybody, right, can decrypt that and prove that you're the one who sent it, because you're the only one that has the secret key. So that's authentication. So public key is good for both confidentiality, sending secret messages, and authentication, which is proving the sender is who they say that they are. If we add some other things in there, like hashing or message digest functions, we can get a third property involved, which is integrity. So to think about this, what I've laid out here, Alice, who's the red-haired lady with the phone there, she's going to compute a one-way hash or message digest of a message, which is taking the hash of a message. She's going to then compute a digital signature, which is applying her private key to encrypt that message digest. She's going to concatenate that with the message to create a message and a signature, and then she's going to encrypt the whole thing using Bob's public key, which he made available to her through some directory or send it to her directly. That person in the middle there, Eve, the eavesdropper, she's going to be clueless on all this because she cannot reverse the computation to decrypt that whole message. She doesn't have Bob's private key, so she's not going to be able to break it. Bob, on the other hand, is when he gets the message, he's going to apply his private key to decrypt and get back the message and the signature. He's then going to use Alice's public key to compute another copy of the message digest, and he's going to digest the message that he decrypted from the message and compare those. And if they match, then he knows, in fact, he got a secret signed message from Alice, and the integrity is intact. That's really powerful, right? And that's the basis of everything that we do on the internet. SSL, TLS, VPNs, financial encryptions, e-money, things like that, that's the basis for everything. But what if Eve, the eavesdropper, could actually break that encryption to discover the message? Then we'd be in a lot of trouble, right? Well, let's look at some of the mathematics behind, breaking that. What are we talking about? One of the popular public key algorithms that's out there is RSA. Has anybody, done RSA encryption before, worked with that? Can you get out a paper and pencil and do some RSA right now? Probably not, because you were talking about hundreds of digits, right? But I can show you an example just using some numbers from, a few digits long to get the basic idea across. The idea is you have two prime numbers, P and Q, which are prodigiously long. Let's just say hundreds of digits. And then you calculate a number called the modulus, which is equal to P times Q. Now, if I asked you to just find the factors of 24, that's pretty easy, right? 1 and 24 is a trivial case. 2 and 12, 3 and 8, 4 and 6. You and I can do that in our heads. If I ask you to find all the factors of 3, 8, 4, 9, 6, 7, 8, 7, 2, 3, 6, 4, 7, 2, 6, 7, 4, you know, it quickly goes beyond what our capability is to do off the top of our head, unless you're like a savant. And then if you keep going with those numbers, it quickly goes off the page of what even a computer can do. All right, so in RSA, after you calculate your modulus, you also calculate something called a totient, an Euler totient, which is equal to P minus 1 times Q minus 1. Then you select a public key, E, which has no factors in common with, or is what we call relatively prime with, the totient T. And then you find a private key, D, such that basically you're saying ED minus 1 over the totient will divide evenly. In other words, no remainder after division. Then it's pretty simple to encrypt. Your ciphertext is taking some message. A message is just what? An integer or a string of integers. You raise it to the E power, which is a public key power, and then mod, that's a modulo function of the modulus. When I say modulo, I'm saying remainder after division, okay? Then to decrypt, to get that message back again, you take the ciphertext and you raise it to the private key power, mod the modulus. Pretty simple, right? Let's just do a quick example. I'm going to take some large hundreds of digits long numbers. No, I'm not. I'm just going to take 3 and 11, right? Two primes. Then to get the modulus, P times Q, 33. To get the totient, P minus 1 times Q minus 1 is 20. So then I choose a number that's relatively prime to the totient T. Well, I can't use 1. That's not going to work. 2, nope, that's not relatively prime because it's a common factor. The first number I come to that's small enough is 3. So I'm going to use 3 as my public key. Then I need to find out a private key D such that ED minus 1 over T will divide evenly. And if you just do kind of some trial and error there, you can figure out that if I use 3 times 7 minus 1, 3 times 7 is 21, minus 1 is 20. 20 divided by 20 divides evenly. Good, I can use that. So now I know what my E key is going to be, my D key is going to be. So just for a simple message like the number 16, if I take that and qubit mod 33, I get 4. So 4 is your encrypted ciphertext. If I take those keys and encrypt RSA, to decrypt it, I just take 4 and raise it to the private key power, mod the modulus, and I get back to my original plain text 16. What is the power of this? The power of this, again, is the resistance of that modulus to being factored into two numbers. That's really the strength of it. As long as it's two numbers, hundreds of digits long, that are multiplied together, guess I haven't touched that in a while. I lost my screen. There we go. We can make sure that this number cannot be encrypted or cannot be broken by any kind of classical computer. All right. So where does quantum computing come in and how does it affect this? This is the stuff that like blew my mind. I was having weird dreams about it. Is anybody taking quantum physics? Just 2 or 3 people, 4 people in the audience. I hadn't taken it in college. I have been teaching, you know, an intro to cryptography class at USF for like 20 years. And I decided I needed to get smart on this because this is, you know, where all the research papers are going now. And so I took this challenge to understand this, this whole topic. But as I got into it, I found this quote by Niels Bohr interesting. Anybody who thinks they can talk about quantum mechanics without getting dizzy hasn't understood the first word of it. And this is like basically one of the authors of it. So let's go to the basics of quantum mechanics and understand how that works first, so then we can understand how quantum computers are constructed. All right, so throughout the 1800s, Maxwell and others were convinced that light behaved like a wave, and they had good reason to, because a guy by the name of Young did a double slit experiment back in 1801, where he showed that if I have this this screen and it's got two holes in it, two slits, and light goes through there, you'll actually see patterns showing up on an optical screen on the other side that are in a very specific manner. So all those light areas is constructive interference, which means more light hits there. Constructive means, you know, light has this sinusoidal kind of waveform look to it. If it's in phase with another light beam, then the two will add their two waves together, and it will be constructive, more light. If they're out of phase with each other, then the two waves will cancel each other out, and you'll have a destructive interference, which is darkness. It just turns out that the exact bandwidth of those bands that show up on the screen behind is the frequency of the light. This is pretty cool and pretty amazing that they, you know, discovered this back in the early 1800s. And we were all on board with this for, you know, about 100 years until we figured out that the same thing happens when we send a single electron through the slot. And that doesn't make any sense. Why would a single electron behave like a wave? Okay. Well, in 27, the Davison and Germer double slit experiment sent through a single electrons and saw the same basically interference pattern happening. As electrons were sent through the double slit, they would diffract and they would interfere and they would fall into these same exact types of patterns. Okay, so that means light isn't really a wave, it's a particle, but yet it is a wave also. So it actually has characteristics of each. Later on, they even showed this, and this blew my mind, is that a single electron going through the screen will actually diffract itself and interfere with itself. Okay, it doesn't even have to be like two electrons going through. The same thing applies to neutrons, or guess what, to any object. Like you and me, would it apply to us? Like if we were going to go through a slit? Anyone? What do you think? This stuff starts to affect reality for me, so it's like worrisome. The answer is yes. You could actually fit through a slit and be diffracted and interfere with yourself and then end up on some other side as long as that slit were small enough. The issue is we have a very small wavelength, very negligible. So you would have to have a slit aperture that's 10 to the minus 36 meters for us to go through, which, you know, it's just not going to work. That's a trillionth of a trillionth of a trillionth of a meter. So, and then you have to have some way to force yourself through that slit. Well, so that's why Newtonian physics appears to be, you know, us and the naked eye, that seems to work just fine because all the things that we can see have a very low wavelength. And so it seems to be that those things hold up. But when you get down to the atomic and subatomic level, that's where everything breaks down. Newtonian physics kind of goes out the window because an electron is smaller than a tiny aperture. And now it's going to behave in a different way than what you would think. So about 1900, they were trying to solve a black body radiation problem. I won't go into the physics all behind that. But Planck theorized that electromagnetic energy or light energy is emitted and absorbed in discrete bundles called quanta. You might know this from chemistry class, right? Where electrons always reside in a shell, which is a particular integer multiple. They can't just go anywhere. They have to reside in a specific energy level. That is all part of quantum theory. Quantums of light are called photons. You know, Planck himself was not actually convinced of the truth of quantum theory until Einstein basically proved it for him. Let's just say if you observe a particle of light, this is the part that's going to get you like just going crazy on this stuff. You're going to change it. So you can't say with certainty the position where that electron is at any given time without changing what that position is. Let me explain this to you a little bit better through Schrodinger's equation. All right. So just as force equals mass times acceleration is kind of the tour de force for Newtonian physics, Schrodinger's equation is the same thing applied to quantum systems. That psi function there, that's a psi, which is the wave function of a particle, shows you where it's likely to be at any given time, not necessarily where it is. We lose, all right. Sorry about that, guys. There we go. And the principle of superposition means that it is could be really anywhere simultaneously at the same time. So remember when the electron was starting out, it was going through the slits, and then it was going to end up somewhere on the other side on that screen. The reason it looked like some of them ended up in between the two slits, even though there's no way it could have gone in between the two slits, is because of this superposition principle. You don't know entirely where it ended up until you actually look at the screen on the other side and see where it ended up. Before that time, it could end up in any position. Whew, okay. All right, so the bottom line is quantum systems are not deterministic. They are probabilistic. Heard of the thought experiment around Schrodinger's cat? I heard a funny application of this to backups. You know, backups are only as good as when you actually restore them and bring them back up. And until that time, they're in a state of dead and aliveness. Okay, so the thought experiment is you have this cat, a flask of poison, and a radioactive source. If you have an internal Geiger counter in the box and it detects any kind of radioactivity, it breaks the flask and kills the cat. So if you think about it, Heisenberg, Bohr, the whole Copenhagen interpretation of quantum theory is that these, you know, waves don't actually have any physical nature. They only have possibilities. All right. So in that way, you can think of an object as being simultaneously zero or one, alive or dead. Until we actually open the box and look and see if the cat is alive or dead, it could be anywhere in between. It could be mostly alive but partially dead or somewhere in between. Once you open the box and find out, it's no longer one or the other. It is that one thing. So you've changed it. So that poses the question then of exactly when quantum superposition ceases and reality collapses from one possibility to the other. All right, this stuff is, I think about this, you know, the Greeks thought of the physical world as just a byproduct of the spiritual world, and then they tried to come up with, you know, some reasoning behind that, and maybe they weren't that far off, you know. In my mind, you know, quantum mechanics makes you either feel like overwhelmed and anxious because you're like, how can we really know? You know, maybe we're inside of a big simulation that's, you know, somebody else is running. Or it can just make you feel like, you know, confident, serene. There seems to be some kind of intelligent design behind all this and structure behind the mechanics. And we can describe this with equations. All right. So, quantum computing. Classical computers, as we know, store digits in ones and zeros, binary. They can either be on or off. They're switches, like a light switch. What happens if your light switch is in the middle position? It's either on or off. It doesn't matter because you're either going to reach the threshold where the switch turns on or off. But what if you had a quantum computer which stored information in something called a quantum bit or a qubit? The superposition state, as we've talked about before, is infinite possibilities. So it is in some state between on and off, and it could be all of them. So a quantum computer is going to execute problems through a network of huge, you know, quantum logic gates and try to make measurements. Usually these are achieved in a number of different ways I can tell you about in a minute, but a lot of times it has to do with superconducting junction devices, so supercooled junctions which have a very low friction. You've ever heard of Moore's Law? This is the observation by Gordon Moore, the founder of Intel, some years ago in the 60s or 70s, where he was saying the number of transistors on a microprocessor doubles roughly every 2 years. And then he modified that later on to say just about every 18 months. So if you look back in time, I remember my very first Apple II Plus in 1978. That was a 1 megahertz processor. The IBM PC 83, 4.77 megahertz. By the time the mid-90s, you had some nice Pentiums, which you could, you know, do a lot more, had a lot more horsepower. Up to the present day, if you have like a nice MacBook Pro or Mac Pro, that's a that does 3.5 gigahertz and, you know, a 6-core or 8-core, 2.7 gigahertz processor, 12-core Xeon, you know, that is tens of thousands or millions of times faster than what we had in the 70s. So another way to look at this is back in the 1930s, a guy by the name of Alan Turing came up with a hypothetical machine that he said, we can simulate any computer algorithm, no matter how complicated it is. Has anybody ever, I remember, has anyone ever taken finite automata theory? Okay, not my actual favorite class at USF, but pretty interesting. You have this finite state machine, and you pull this like tape through it, and if you lay out the tapes to change states, you can actually formulate any algorithm, no matter how complicated. So Turing Church's thesis said you can functionally calculate anything if it can be solved by a Turing machine. All right, so back to Moore's law. Back in 1945, rather, the ENIAC computer, University of Pennsylvania, weighed 27 tons. That means it took 10 billion atoms to represent one bit. Reversing kind of Moore's law from how many transistors you can fit on a chip to basically how many atoms does it take to actually code a transistor, we've seen that cutting by half every 18 months since then. So by the 2000, Pentium 4 had approximately 50 million transistors. Today, I got a picture of the coronavirus here. A modern transistor is 22 nanometers. A flu virus is about 80 nanometers, and they have actually trouble finding those on, you know, it's hard to actually look at those under a microscope. They're so small. And we're saying a modern transistor is a quarter of the size of a flu virus. Remember that the double slit and the size of the thing and the wavelength? When we reach the atomic scale, odd things start to happen and Turing no longer holds. The superposition of bits, of qubits, is what gives a quantum computer its power. Because we can say something is simultaneously in multiple states within a qubit, and that gives you parallelism. Parallelism allows a quantum computer to work on a million computations at once, while your desktop PC can do like one. So whereas we are measuring your desktop PC in gigabits or gigaflops, billions of floating point operations per second, a 30-qubit quantum computer would have the equivalent processing power of 10 teraflops because of its massive parallelism. So now we have to kind of modify the Turing thesis to something by Deutsch, who's a Oxford professor, I believe, over in England, to say that a universal computing device or quantum computer can simulate every physical process. So now we have to say, we can't just say a classical computer could do it, because a classical computer can't do things when we get down to the subatomic level. So now we have to say a quantum computer can do anything. In order to build a quantum computer, you have to have basically four requirements. You have to be able to represent quantum bits or qubits. You have to be able to, controllable unit development means you have to be able to correct for leakage and stochastic control errors. So you have to have some way to look and correct and do error correcting codes. You have to be able to affect the qubit states. This is actually tricky. We're going to talk about entanglement in a minute because, and other methods, because, remember what I said before, you can't observe the qubit or you change it to one state or the other, which turns it into a classical computer. So how am I going to observe it and change it without looking at it? Okay, entanglement. That's the answer. All right, and then you also have to know what the final state of the qubit is. You know, just like when we saw the electron get to the screen on the other side, it would be nice to know where it actually finally landed. You know, it had potential to land anywhere, but it did finally land somewhere, and that's where we cause the quantum state to collapse into a binary state. All those things are needed to run a quantum computer. All right, let's talk about qubits. What are qubits? Well, that's qubits. Sorry, got the wrong thing there. Because qubits can neither be one or zero at the same time, which is based on superposition principle, it only takes n qubits to handle 2 to the n states. So something that would take an exponential amount of time on a classical computer can be handled essentially in a linear amount of time on a quantum computer. So you can see there, 20 qubits, you're up to megabytes. By the time you get up to a 50 qubit, you're talking about petabytes. So if you were just going to look for, say, a repeating pattern of trillions of digits long on a classical computer that goes off into the weeds, 2 to the n steps, on a quantum computer, a linear amount of time, only n steps. I was looking at a video by this lady who's the head of the Berkeley quantum computing lab, and she said once we get to about the 100 qubit machine, you're actually going to run into some issues. Technical challenges in maintaining the system, environmental issues, how do you super cool the computer, implementing the controls, quantum decoherence, which means, unfortunately, nobody's been able to do this at a large scale yet because quantum physics itself starts breaking down. I think the largest one we've seen so far is a 54 qubit system, and they can only get 53 of the qubits working because that last one just starts making everything break. But the cool thing is, if we were able to get to 1,000 qubits, you would be able to compute things that could not be computed in the entire lifetime of the universe. So on a classical supercomputer. So let's just take the most powerful supercomputer in the world, let it run forever. It's still not going to be faster than what we can do with a quantum computer at 1,000 qubits. Seen different research papers on this. Some say it would take thousands of qubits to break RSA. Others say millions of qubits still needed. But long and short, RSA is going to go bye-bye pretty soon. How do you control those qubits inside of a quantum computer? Different methods. An ion trap is basically using an optical or magnetic field or some kind of combination of that to trap ions. An optical trap is using light waves to trap and control the particles. Quantum dots are made of semiconductor material and used to contain and manipulate electrons. Semiconducting impurities. This is really interesting. They actually contain electrons by using unwanted atoms that are found in a semiconductor material. That one's really cool. And then the one that we're going to look at with the Google quantum computer is superconducting circuits, which allow the electrons to flow with almost no resistance at very low temperatures. I was going to play a little video here to show you an example of superconductivity, but unfortunately I'm having some audio issues. Maybe I can still show you the video. And
there's a wonderful demonstration that I find eye-popping no matter how many times I've seen it. Maybe some of you have seen it before. We have our fingers crossed. Omalon, can you come out one more time with our with quantum levitation, if you would, which is a stunning demonstration of, again, some of the strange ways in which quantum mechanics allows the world to work in ways that, again, a classical intuition would not expect. And Omalon does this freehand. I'm going to stand back. And you want me to actually touch it? Well, I'm going to wear a glove. He only wears it to look like he's being responsible. I see him do this with the bare hand all the time. Yeah, that's just crazy. All right, that's That's like 77 degrees or something, you know, Kelvin, which is cold. Okay, so let's just go right to the disk, if you would. And if you just put that there, and then I'm going to give this a little bit of a push around. Can you see that up on the, can you get a shot of that?
That guy looking on is Nobel physicist, Nobel Prize winning physicist, and he's even just staggered by this demonstration. I mean, it's just so incredible.
Bring up the final slide that we have here. It's called quantum locking. It was a wonderful application of quantum ideas that originated with some Israeli physicists who demonstrated this once before. You've got magnetic lines that are penetrating the superconducting disk. It's cold that allows it to be a superconductor, and the threads of these magnetic lines are able to, in some sense, pin this object along this track. The track has a uniform magnetic field, and as long as you keep it cold and superconducting, they will hold it in place. Here's another illustration of these ideas. Look at that. Can you get a close-up of that shot right there? Can you bring that up on the screen? There you go. So you see that's just hovering right there, and there's nothing in between.
Magic.
And can we actually... Can we flip this over and show how that goes? Yeah, so we can take this guy. And do you want... Okay. And do you want a glove? No, you just want to do it by hand there.
That's a stud.
Yeah, okay. More fun that way, he says. Okay, yeah. Wow, that's insane. Okay, now, can you get a shot of that underneath there? It is now hovering underneath. Is a fairly stunning and, yes, right down to earth demonstration of quantum mechanics.
All right. Thanks for indulging me there. I just thought that was a fantastic demo. Coming back over here. All right, so superconducting circuits, based on what you just saw there, are the way that they're able to control qubits. I mentioned quantum entanglement earlier. As we said earlier, the problem with quantum computers is if you try to look at a subatomic particle, you change it. You're either going to make it a zero or a one. So basically, you have turned your quantum computer into a classical computer. So they had to devise some clever ways of making measurements indirectly and controlling qubits indirectly to preserve the system integrity. In quantum physics, it turns out if you apply an outside force to two atoms, it can cause them to become entangled, which means the second atom takes on properties of the first or opposite properties of the first. So scientists can actually know the value of the qubits without looking at them. If left alone, an atom is actually going to try to spin in all directions. The instant it is disturbed, it chooses one spin or value. And at the same time, the second entangled atom will also choose the opposite spin or value. So by looking at, observing, or manipulating an adjacent atom, you can make a qubit have another value without looking at it. This stuff's just kind of, we're kind of like building something a little bit ahead of completely understanding the theory, kind of like that Large Hadron Collider in Switzerland, you know, it could or could not create a singularity in a black hole and kill us all, but it's kind of cool to try to find out, right? I feel kind of the same way with quantum computers. You can get a group of physicists up on a stage and they'll actually argue with each other how stuff actually works. And yet here we are trying to make computers that implement quantum physics. So what? Why do we care about all this? Well, it looks like a quantum computer that could break RSA is still only theoretical at this point and likely a few years away. But now it's the time to prepare. Why is that? Well, you see the that tweet there? That was actually about something that happened a few months ago where NordVPN's keys, their private keys, became public. That means anybody who ever captured any traffic encrypted with a NordVPN could just decrypt it at their own leisure, right? And read all that private data. We have nation states that are doing this right now. We know for a fact China tries to route everything past past its core routers so they can take a snapshot of it, archive it off. And then at a later time, when they develop a quantum computer, they'll just go back, decrypt it all, and now they'll be able to read every encrypted thing that was ever sent on the internet. Privacy, information, nation-state secrets, financial transactions, they'll have it all. So anyone could really record sensitive communications now and try to decipher them later when we have quantum computers up and running. Every day that we don't have a post-quantum cryptography in place is a day that data has been leaked. According to Bernstein, University of Illinois, Chicago, we need time for three things: to improve the efficiency of post-quantum or quantum-resistant algorithms, to build confidence in using them, and to improve the usability of post-quantum. That's why the time is now to get serious about this. If you look at, that's Peter Shore there. As we said back in the, talking about RSA and public key, if Eve, the eavesdropper, could factor the public key into its component primes, she could just steal that private key and crack everything. Factoring large numbers, very difficult for classical computers, takes thousands or millions of years. For a quantum computer, theoretically, not so much. A guy by the name of Shore is the one who first theorized this back in 94. There's another guy by the name of Grover, who had another quantum algorithm that finds the probability of unique input to a black box function, which basically reduces something from order of square root of n calculations down to order of n calculations. So basically, he's talking about cutting time in half to solve a lot of these encryption problems. Here's the bottom line. By 2026, we have about a 1-in-7 chance that we're that 2048-bit RSA, which is kind of the standard for everything encrypted on the internet, is going to be broken. By 2031, there's a 1 out of 2 chance of breaking those. And those estimates were made actually a few years ago. They could be a little bit off by now because we've seen some great advancements in quantum computing. This is kind of a money slide here from Bernstein, where he says, all right, what effect does quantum computing have on, say, advanced encryption standard 128-bit? Well, using Grover in a quantum computer, we could get that down to, it's only worth, 64 bits of security now. AES-256, that only takes it down to 128. So basically, a classical symmetric cipher like AES and some of these hashing functions like SHA-256, it cuts their security in half. But a public key crypto system like RSA, Diffie-Hellman, Key Exchange, Elliptic Curve, those are broken utterly and completely because they're based on either factoring numbers, factoring two primes multiplied together, or they're based on discrete log, which is essentially a similar related problem. So those are all going to be broken. This is kind of scary. How close are we? Well, last year, Google published a paper in the journal Nature called Quantum Supremacy Using a Programmable Superconducting Processor. If you look up quantum supremacy, that's a term that was coined by a Caltech physicist named John Preskill that says it's when the point when a quantum computer can do stuff faster than a classical computer, even the world's fastest supercomputer. So what they did is they calculated a how many minutes is that? Damn. Who wants me to keep going? All right. I'm going to speed up. It's going to leave me less time for questions at the end, but hopefully we're going to get through some real good material here. All right. Don't panic yet. Sycamore, which is the Google computer, has to be kept at cryogenically cold temperatures. When they got to 54 qubits, it started to break down with quantum decoherence, so they can only get 53 qubits working. The problem that it solved was not RSA. It was just some specifically contrived problem, and they kind of overstated how powerful it was. Like, they were saying that a supercomputer would take 10,000 years to do it. IBM was like, nope, our supercomputer did that same problem in a couple of days. So they were kind of overstating the problem. Nevertheless, it's still a breakthrough. All right, moving towards the end, what can we do? Got two choices. Post-quantum cryptography, which is coming up with algorithms that are resistant to quantum computers, or quantum cryptography, which is using quantum systems to create cryptography. The second one I'm not going to go into because it's very difficult right now. For the same reason it is difficult to construct a quantum computer, creating a crypto system that uses quantum cryptography is difficult because, now, this is cool. You could send it's perfectly provably secure to send a key. It could have any possible value, and if somebody looks at it, they've tampered it, and now you know it's no longer has that value. So it's unbreakable, but yet it's going to require some kind of quantum repeaters because the fiber optic links that to send those keys is very difficult and it's very short distance. All right, so let's look at post-quantum cryptography. All right, this makes me cry because this is like the whole meat of the thing. All right, NIST is evaluating a bunch of cryptography algorithms that are post-quantum. They're quantum safe. They start out with 69, they got it down to 26, and now there's 13. By this time, in a couple of years, they're going to have a basic set of crypto algorithms that we can use. Those are lattice-based systems. I'm going to make these slides available to everybody online, okay? Because lattice is incredibly difficult. I have never seen a very good breakdown of the basics of it. It's mostly just math. And so this is one of the few places, saying what a lattice-based crypto system is and how it can be used. Error detecting codes are also another way to do post-quantum that are quantum safe. All right. And the long and short is quantum means PK is broken. We need to act now to get standardized algorithms. Lattice and error-correcting codes are the ways to go about that. But we still need to show their resistance against quantum attacks, side-channel attacks, and so forth. Let's talk more after this. I'm very sorry for going over. Thanks.